Buenas noches a todos. Subimos un poquito justamente esta parte, o pongamos el video, quiero que aprovechen y vean un video especialmente armado.
En 1918 fueron colocadas en el Monte Scopus en Jerusalén las piedras fundamentales de la Universidad Hebrea, 12 aludiendo a las antiguas tribus hebreas y otras 2 por las comunidades cristiana y musulmana. Fue inaugurada oficialmente en abril de 1925 mientras uno de sus fundadores, Albert Einstein, se encontraba en su histórica visita a la Argentina. Entre los oradores se hallaban personalidades de la política y la cultura de la época. Lord Balfour, Chaim Weizmann, el Rabino Cook, Herbert Samuel y Chaim Nachman Bialik. En 1921, el profesor Einstein recibió el Premio Nobel de Física y en 1923 dictó la primera conferencia científica sobre su teoría de la relatividad en el incipiente campus del Monte Scopus. Albert Einstein fue miembro de la Junta de Gobernadores y presidió el primer comité académico de la universidad. Desde sus comienzos, la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén se propuso alcanzar logros significativos en la ciencia, con una mirada judía hacia la humanidad toda. La Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén es sinónimo de innovación y excelencia en el campo de la enseñanza y la investigación aplicada. Ha contribuido significativamente a la prosperidad económica de la ciudad de Jerusalén, así como del Estado de Israel. Tanto en el cuerpo de profesores como en el alumnado, la Universidad Hebrea cuenta con renombradas figuras en un amplio espectro de emprendimientos científicos y académicos, como los premios Nobel Israel Aumann, Daniel Kahneman, Abraham Hershko, Aaron Siechanover, David Gross, Roger Kronberg, y Ada Yonat, y Elon Lindenstrauss, galardonado con la medalla Fields de Matemáticas. En 1964, la Universidad Hebrea creó ISUM, la compañía de transferencia tecnológica para darle valor a los sorprendentes logros de sus científicos y académicos en la investigación de vanguardia, y es responsable de la protección y la comercialización de la propiedad intelectual de estos grandes avances, inventos y conocimiento generado en las facultades de la universidad y sus estudiantes. Hasta hoy, ISUM ha registrado más de 9.300 patentes, que involucran más de 2.600 invenciones, con licencias por más de 880 tecnologías, generando numerosas startups y compañías spin-off. Productos basados en las innovaciones de la Universidad Hebrea han atraído inversiones de Intel, Novartis, Roche, Johnson & Johnson, Teva, Merck, Google, Adobe Systems, Monsanto, Syngenta, Bill Morin, entre otras compañías israelíes e internacionales. Con determinación y talento, producimos cambios que mejoran la salud y la vida de las personas. Tal es el caso de la profesora Marta Weinstock-Rosin, del Instituto para la Investigación Farmacológica, que junto con su equipo ha desarrollado Exelon, una droga que retarda el avance del Alzheimer, de la que se benefician más de 1 millón de pacientes anualmente. El profesor Yehezkel Barnholz, de la Facultad de Medicina, junto con sus colegas, desarrollaron Doxil, una droga para el tratamiento del carcoma de Kaposi, el cáncer de ovarios, el mieloma múltiple y el cáncer de pulmón. El profesor Chaim Rabinovich, de la Facultad de Agricultura, Alimentación y Ambiente, estableció las bases genéticas creando cultivos larga vida en frutas y verduras, convirtiendo a los tomates cherry en un commodity global. El profesor Oded Yoseyov desarrolló la tecnología para la producción de colágeno humano, un componente esencial en centenares de productos medicinales usados en ortopedia, cardiología, diabetes y cicatrización. el profesor Shmuel Peleg, de la Escuela de Ingeniería y Ciencia de la Computación, desarrolló la tecnología que sintetiza 24 horas de grabación en pocos minutos. Tecnología de uso necesario para preservar la seguridad. Briefcam, la startup surgida de esta invención, vendió su producto para la seguridad de los Juegos Olímpicos de Río de Janeiro. El profesor Amnon Yashua inventó Mobileye, un sistema diseñado para prevenir accidentes, alertar en tiempo real al conductor de situaciones peligrosas y condiciones de manejo. El sistema fue adquirido por las principales automotrices del mundo y es un equipamiento estándar en sus vehículos. La Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén, con 23.000 estudiantes de 80 países del mundo, es parte de una red global de colaboración en el campo de la investigación y la educación.
היה קטן מדי. באמת לא יכולנו לחלום יותר, מה היה לנו? מעט אדמה, שבצפונה היו ביצות, ובדרומה מדבר, כמעט ארץ ללא מים, שני אגמים, אחד מת, השני גובע קצת, נער אחד, מפורסם וגדול הירדן, שזרמה בו יותר פרסומת מאשר מים, כמעט ללא קשמים, ללא אוצרות טבע, לא זהב, אפילו לא נפט. ואני שואל את עצמי, מה קרה? איך יצאנו מזה? תשובתי היא רק אחד. גילינו, וזה אולי הגילוי המדעי החשוב ביותר שאני יכול לחשוב עליו, שהאוצר הגדול ביותר ביקום הוא האדם עצמו. עם שלא הייתה לו ברירה, מצא את הברירה האנושית. ישראל איננה ארץ שבירקה את יושביה, היא ארץ שיושביה ברכו את עמם. והשגיאה השנייה, שלא הערכנו מספיק את התוצאה של החלום הקטן. המציאות שנוצרה מהחלום הקטן היא מציאות אדירה. שבארץ הזו ימצאו כל כך הרבה כישרונות מדעיים ואנושיים, ושישראל הקטנה במידותיה גדולה במדעיה. לא גודל הארץ קובע, אלא גודל החוכמה השוכנת בארץ הוא הקובע אם היא גדולה והיא מקטנה. ועליי להוסיף, תתחילו בחלום גדול יותר, אבל אל תשכחו שצריך גם לעבוד קשה כדי שהחלום הזה יהפך למציאות עוד יותר גדולה. אני רוצה להגיד מילה למסיימי הקורס. סיימתם ללמוד, עכשיו אתם צריכים להתחיל לבנות. למדתם כדי לחדש ולא רק כדי לשנן. האוניברסיטה העברית היא המוסד החופשי והאמין והחיובי ביותר שישנו במזרח התיכון כולו.
Hola, ¿qué tal? Buenas noches, ¿cómo estamos? ¿Todo bien? Seguramente después de ver este video un poco más inspirado todos nosotros, ¿no? Bueno, les comento que tenemos una noche realmente muy particular porque tenemos la oportunidad de escuchar a dos distinguidos profesores de la Universidad de Hebrea de Jerusalén hablando de temas que nos van a impactar a cada uno de nosotros. A los dos profesores que vamos a escuchar, el profesor Jaime Rabinovich y el profesor Shlomo Hasson, tuve la oportunidad de conocerlos en mi viaje de hace muy poquito a Israel. Y yo creo que lo que decía Shimon Peres se hace realidad en ellos. Uno puede hablar de los descubrimientos, las innovaciones, las contribuciones y los aportes que ellos hicieron, no no solamente a la universidad, sino al Estado de Israel y a la humanidad en general. Pero fundamentalmente, y creo que eso es importante, tuve la posibilidad de conocer a dos seres humanos excepcionales. Y yo quisiera que hoy ustedes traten de rescatar que detrás de profesores extraordinarios hay personas que tienen una historia individual, familiar, de conexión con la universidad, con el Estado de Israel y con el judaísmo, que realmente es maravillosa. Con lo cual, tener la posibilidad, y les soy honesto, y cuando estuve en Israel, Edu Polak, era una especie de mi guía de todo lo que tenía que ver, y me dijo, prestale atención a estos profesores, digo, tratá de darte cuenta la magnitud de la gente. Y yo creo que nosotros muchas veces naturalizamos la posibilidad de hablar y escuchar a gente como ellos. Les aseguro que son excepcionales, tienen un nivel, un contenido, una experiencia. Le preguntaba hace un ratito al profesor Cazón, le decía, ¿cuántas conferencias habrás dado en tu vida? ¿Sabes cuál fue la respuesta? Miles. ¿Ustedes entienden? Una persona que dio miles de conferencias. Con Jaime Gabilovich, que estuvimos preparando para Kiki y trabajando mucho, contaba la infinidad de viajes, de lugares del mundo donde habló, y cuando decíamos, tenés que hablar tantos minutos, y contaba la cantidad de experiencias en las cuales tuvo que ir de un lado para otro y le decían de tanto tiempo, después menos tiempo, no andaba la computadora. Bueno, son gente que sabe mucho. La sugerencia, la recomendación es aprovecharlos al máximo, tenemos la posibilidad de tenerlos acá, para pocos, en vivo y en directo. Entonces, les comento entonces cuáles son los antecedentes de ellos. El profesor Jaime Rabinovich, que va a ser quien va a hablar primero, es ex rector de la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén, ex decano y profesor emérito de la Facultad de Agricultura, Alimentos y Medio Ambiente. Fue el primer académico de la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén en haber sido nombrado rector de la casa. Fue investigador visitante y profesor invitado en universidades de Europa y Estados Unidos y experto visitante de las Naciones Unidas en países en desarrollo. Desarrolló innovadoras tecnologías genéticas que generan condiciones de larga vida y mejor gusto para diversos cultivos. Es reconocido mundialmente por lograr el patentamiento y comercialización de los tomates cherry y sus derivados, entre otros, y líder en la restauración floral y fertilidad del ajo. Su innovador trabajo ha impulsado la agricultura sustentable, tema del cual se habla muchísimo hoy, que le valió prestigiosos premios internacionales. Vamos a escuchar primero al profesor Jaime Rabinovich. Les adelanto quién es el profesor Shlomo Jasson, que va a hablarnos después. Es profesor emérito y director del Centro Yasha de Estudios Estratégicos de la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén. Es profesor en pensamiento estratégico en la Escuela de Políticas Públicas de la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén y consultor del gobierno en el ámbito de la planificación estratégica nacional. Su reciente libro, que lo vi y es una maravilla, Israel 2048, Desarrollo Espacial y Planificación, fue publicado por el Ministerio de Finanzas, el Centro de Estudios Estratégicos Yasha y la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén. Pero les garantizo algo, más allá de todo lo que leí, son maravillosos seres humanos. Y desde nuestro punto de vista, eso es lo importante, que la universidad no solamente brinda conocimiento, sino que además nos permite la oportunidad de conectarnos con personas que son extraordinarias como seres humanos. Profesor, ¿me va a callar?
Very good evening to you. I'd like to say welcome, shalom to all of you. Glad to be here, glad that you are here. And let's have had next half an hour or so some information about agriculture, about our contribution to the benefit of human beings. Chesmanet and Bank used to have an advertisement, and they still use it, and they say, you have a friend in Chesmanet. About 20 years ago, Bank Leumi decided to open a branch in Fifth Avenue, just in front of Chesmanet Bank. And they put a banner that say, but in Bank Leumi, you have a mishpocha. Chesmanet Bank did not wait long, And the next week they came out with another banner that said that we such mishpocha in this year. This is my 15th year that I visit Argentina and Uruguay and Brazil and Chile and other countries. And I have to say that with this crowd I feel like in a friendly mishpocha. So thank you very much for this. My name, as you know, is Chaim Rabinowitz. I'm a staff member and professor emeritus at the Faculty of Agriculture, Food and Environment, currently headed by Professor Shmuel Wolf. We are the only faculty of agriculture in Israel, and by having said that, I could easily say that we are the best faculty of agriculture in Israel, but if you want, I can say that we are the worst one. It will be the same. About 20 years ago, when I served as the dean of the faculty, we recognized the fact that we need to restructure, because agriculture becomes an interdisciplinary science. It involves environment, it involves food, it involves animal sciences and plant sciences. We restructured the faculty in the shape of a flower, but each wing of this, each leaf of this flower, plant sciences interact with animal sciences. After all, animals eat plants, as with environment sciences, food sciences, and so on and so forth. And this helped a lot in building new type of science and new innovation. Some of them I'll mention today. In our faculty, there are about 2,400 students. About two-thirds of them are undergraduates, 25% of them are graduate students. And we have also the only school in Israel of veterinary medicine. So again, the best school in Israel, if you like. We offer 15 different study programs and 500 different courses annually. And this is all done by and also we share our knowledge, our new knowledge, with the rest of the world. We have an international school for the cultural science for people. So we share our knowledge with the international community. We have a school, International School of Agriculture. We have like 800 students from all over the world, from China to South America, from Europe, from the United States, and elsewhere. To serve all these students, we have 85 tenured academic staff. This is, of course, not sufficient to provide 15 different programs and 500 courses. So these are supported by 200 adjunct teachers, the majority of whom are former graduates of ours who work now in different academic institutions, and they come and provide courses, specific courses, to complement whatever is needed. Yeah, one of my great prides is the achievement to break the glass ceiling of women in academia. I started it when I was a dean and continued it when I served as a rector of the university. And as with regard to the faculty, you can see that today 55% of the students are female, 50% of the graduate students, the research students, are female, 50% of the junior staff are female. But still, we are left behind with the senior staff, but this is very difficult to get. I called the labor exchange and asked for 20 female professors. They said, we don't have today, maybe you come tomorrow and we find some. They have to be cultured, they have to be cultivated. And I hope that when I stand here in this hall in 20 years from now, it could be shown that it will definitely be. Now, agri is our culture. This is true from biblical times, and I have a citation from the Bible. It's in Spanish, so it's easy for you to read. And the Lord said to Moses, send men to get knowledge about the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the children of Israel. In other words, he sent spies to the land of Canaan in order to see what happens there. I haven't been the head of intelligence of Moses. I would say, bring me information about the terrain, about the geography, whether there is water there, what are the people, are there soldiers, are the towns fortified or not fortified, what is it? But in the best tradition of the Jewish people, food is number one. And when the spies come back, what do they tell Moses? They tell him, we came to the land where you sent us, and it's truly flowing with milk and honey, and there is some of this produce in it, and this produce is grapes. So nothing about what happened supposed to be. Joshua has to fight Jericho, and only King David managed to conquer Jerusalem. No information about what the army actually did, but it's food there, so it's okay. So it's all about food, if you like. And it's not surprising that McDonald's takes advantage of that. And McDonald's offer, try our mac matzah, made of bacon, eggs, and cheese on very tasty matzah. So this is a good way to say it. It's our people, isn't it? Now, Janis Joplin, one of the best singers of the 20th century, once said, now that I'm here, here means on planet Earth, where am I? She was very curious and very good singer, and I'd like to welcome you to Israel. And this is the only country in the world where Christmas comes and this person comes with a bag, is asked at the airport, did you pack it your own? So it's not. They don't. Just to be sure. Some physical information about Israel. Israel is 60 years old. This picture was taken on 6th Avenue on the birthday, on 68th birthday. And it says 60 years old, and everyone still wants to fall at the words, you happy birthday, Israel. So it's kind of interesting. And Israel is a land where everything is different than in any other place. For instance, police corps in Lafayette, Indiana. This is a nice picture of the police. If you look at the police in Israel, it looks everywhere. Israel is the only place where there are more women fly F-16s and drivers, women driving to Jerusalem. It's an amazing country, it's an amazing place. Now, when we compare that area, I don't have to tell you that Brazil is 8.5 million square kilometers, Argentina is almost 3, Peru 1.3, and so on, hundreds of thousands of square kilometers, and so on and so forth. Israel is 20,000 kilometers. 1/8 of Uruguay, president of Uruguay. Friend, 1/8 of the country. Actually, if you add all the Caribbeans together, it's much like the land area of Israel. Israel is located on the east side of the Mediterranean, the west side of Asia. It's not Middle East, it's the end, west end of Asia. And you can see that of the 22,000 square kilometers, only 4,000 square kilometers are Arab land, agricultural land. Out of which about 40% is irrigated, the rest is not irrigated. Israel is located in a desert area where the rainfall is less than 100 millimeters per year, not per day. And you can see here that north of Iraq, north of Syria, south of Turkey, Lebanon, and Israel, north of Israel, are the only places in the area where rainfall is more than 200 millimeters. This is what we call the Fertile Crescent. This is where agriculture of the Western world was involved. At the edge of the desert, right on that, 200, 400 millimeters of rain per year. All the area here is desert. Egypt is desert. Jordan is desert. Saudi Arabia is desert. Iraq is desert. South of Syria is desert. And south of Israel is desert. If you get a good look, Israel, you can see that 60% of the country is desert, but the upper, we go northward, the more rain there is, and it's not surprising there is that along the 500 kilometers, this is the total length of Israel, you can go in the morning and do some skiing on Mount Hermon, take your car, even if it's old one, go 5 hours and do scuba diving in the evening. Very same day, and this is true for today, just showing the news that there is no Mount Hermon. Seasons. Here you talk about four seasons usually, spring and summer and fall and winter. In Israel we have only two seasons. We have a rainy season between November and March, mainly between December and February, and we have the dry season, it's so much uncertain that there will not be rain, the some hotels actually are willing to guarantee you that if you come in July and have a drop of rain, you get to pay free, but it's never happened so far. Our faculty was established in 1942. Earlier you heard, or yesterday you heard, that the founding fathers of the Zionist movement built or established the Hebrew University as a foundation for a state to be. The same founding father thought about the fact that here we are in a desert country, and if we want to come there, we have to produce our own food, and we can do it not in a regular way, but we have to do a sophisticated way, and they established Faculty of Agriculture, a School of Agriculture, to make the desert bloom, if you like. Remember the picture of the spies that they come with the grapes, so here they are in real life, that situation. At the beginning, when the state was established, there was really a shortage of food, there was rationing of food, and the main theme was supply food for the people to eat. There wasn't enough of it. David Ben-Gurion said that if the state does not eliminate the desert may eliminate the state, and for that we have to take all measures as our priority for being, by taming the wilderness, by developing water resources, developing technologies in order to provide food for all. So the first thing was, in order to have agriculture, you have to develop water resources, either by technologies, street management, or other things. And it's not surprising that one of the very first things that the state did right in the 50s and 60s, building a national water carrier that carried down water from the Lake of Galilee, the only sweet water lake in Israel, as was said in the spreading the water or distributing the water all the way down to the Negev, to provide water for agriculture even in areas where the rainfall is less than 200 millimeters per year. The thing is that in 1948 we were 600,000 people, today we are 8.5 million people, and existing water resources have been overused, exploited, and there is not sufficient water. We have to develop new technologies in order to get water. So, enhancing of water was done by rain enhancement, sealing clouds with sodium iodide, increased rainfall by 15%. So this is one solution. The other solution is reusing sewage effluents, treating them under strict control of the Ministries of Agriculture and Ministries of Health, reusing them in agriculture. The third one was diverting all kind of brackish water resources from falling into the sweet lake. So here we have the salt water carrier, or the brackish water carrier that carries the water down to the south. These water are not wasted. We grow saline water fish in water that is being carried down south to the Kinneret. Israel is number one in the world, but leading by far, I wish we did in football or basketball, leading by far the use of effluents as compared to all other countries in the world. The other thing was desalination. In 2015, Israel desalinized 600 million cubic meters of water. This is about one third of the total water consumed in Israel. This desalinized water goes as drinking water, the effluent water goes to agriculture. And you can see that until 1992, all the water used in agriculture was potable water, and since then there is an increasing amount of effluent water used in agriculture and decreasing amount of potable water. And we provide all our needs in vegetables, in fruit, in chicken meat, in eggs and milk and other stuff. But using such water caused a problem, because this water carried a lot of minerals and elements, and we had to find solutions in order not to spoil the soil. So we think, we at the university, think one drop ahead all the time. We have to be prepared for the use of such brackish water. And without showing you all the details, I can show you that in 1950, we irrigated the land with 900 cubic meters of water per 1,000 square meters of land. In 1995, it was already 500. So we reduced the amount of water used per square meter by half, but at the same time, efficiency, yield, went up 250%. And this is done since we are the only faculty of agriculture in Israel. I can take some credit for this achievement. Or in other words, the demonstration in 1955, each farmer produced food to sufficient to feed 15 people. In 2014, each farmer produces food to feed 111, and actually in 2016, each farmer produced food to feed 115. This is 6 or 7-fold increase between 1955 and 2014. This places Israel among the top countries in the developed world in agricultural production, and it's not surprising that many countries ask for our assistance in agriculture. How does this happen? It happens because of this connection between skilled growers. Many of the growers study agriculture, academic agriculture. They are in continuous contact with extension officers, graduates of the Faculty of Agriculture. They are happy to adopt technology, and everything streams towards the faculty and back in continuous interaction. Every novelty is immediately applied in the field. Now, they ask me many times if we do GMO, genetically modified organism, or in Italian they say OGM, I don't know how they say it in Spanish. No, we don't do apple orange, and we don't do Baron-Minhausen half horse, and we don't do llama, Dr. Dolittle llama, and we don't do four leg chicken. It would be good for pulkes. We don't do it not because we cannot. We don't do it because our main customers abroad are Europeans, and the Europeans, because of economic reasons, do not agree to accept GMO in Europe. And since they don't want it, we don't produce it and save it. A report came just recently by OECD, says two lines. It says, Israel agriculture is unique among the developed countries, and specifically with regard to arid zone conditions. So Israel is number one in the world in agriculture in arid zone, that is dry areas. Now, this is the Great Rift Valley stretching from Turkey to Lake Victoria. It goes along the Jordan River, and all this stretch between the Dead Sea and Red Sea is a complete desert, 2 millimeters per year. And this is a picture of the area in 1959. This is a complete desert, nothing here, nothing grows here whatsoever. As I said, 2 millimeters of rain per year. 20 years later, with the development and adoption of new technologies and water, you cannot have agriculture without water, this is how it looks like. Now it's still all open fields, as you can see, very little plastic culture here. 20 years later, another picture from exactly the same point, you see almost 100% plastic culture, but low tunnels, not yet developed agriculture. And 10 years later, everything is greenhouse. Now this is not unique to a single settlement village. It happens all over this Great Rift Valley, which became the main source of sweet pepper supply to Europe. 60% of the total export of Israel fresh vegetables come from this area, the desert, the total desert. Just by adoption of technology that was developed in part at the Faculty of Agriculture of the University. Now, when we talk about greenhouses, everyone think immediately about a heavy steel construction, strong steel, glass, automatic roof, ventilation, water piping to carry hot water in order to heat the construction during the winter. This cost $1.5 million per hectare. Israeli greenhouse is like the policeman. It looks like that. It's a very light structure, covered either with polyethylene always net. There's a passive ventilation, not automatic ventilation, nothing like that. It costs about 1/10 of a Dutch greenhouse, but it produces exactly the same. And just as figures, figures of speech, we grow 3 million cut roses per hectare per season in such a greenhouse, and with tomatoes, it's not 350 already tons of tomatoes per season, and there are two seasons per year, so we're talking about 700 tons per hectare per year in this simple low-cost greenhouse that was developed in Israel to adapt to conditions, the environment conditions. We adopt very quick to adopt crops, new crops that may suit our conditions. Remember the brackish water canal. We adopted a plant called Salicornia and now became a hit in Europe. Actually, you cannot buy it in Israel. The European buys the entire product. It grows on almost seawater without any problem. We are domesticating crops. This is truffle. This truffle, this mushroom, cost $2,500, the single truffle. Now, it was partly domesticated. It cannot be fully domesticated. It grows on oak tree roots in a gated area, and farmers can find it easily without pigs and without dogs and without all these things. And we develop our own new crops. This is advertising for Yisum. It refers to Milet. It has an excellent level of fruit soil, attractive appearance, high yields, high percentage of marketable fruit, and so on and so forth. Israel today is number 5 in the world in export of vegetable seeds, mainly tomatoes. And when I say that, you can say 75% come from the university. David Ben-Gurion said once, the genuine international partnership will not be possible as long as there is a huge difference in standard of living, health and education between nations. This is really true with regard to the Middle East. There won't be able to be peace between Israeli and Palestinians as long as there will be a huge difference in standard of living, in healthcare and things like that. So we are, as I told you before, we are happy to share at the Faculty of Agriculture. We have courses and workshops and development projects in joint IRD and regional. Yeah? I shut down, it's no problem. Okay. So here you can see a graduate of ours is an extension officer. He teaches these ladies in Central Africa how to grow crops in a modern way. And you can see there's a drip irrigation here, the most modern technology of water supply to plant that was developed in Israel. We talk a lot about innovation, and we didn't do that yet. You cannot deliver pizza through as attachment by internet, not yet, but maybe one day we should do it. We did a lot about recycling. As I told you before, we are very careful about environment, not this type of recycling. A number of years ago, we decided strategically to use coal in order to have power plants make energy. When you use coal, there's a lot of smog on one hand, and there are ashes produced. Actually, mountains of ashes are produced. Now, what happens when there is a wind from the ocean? Obviously, all the neighborhoods are covered with this ashes, and it's dirt and environment hazards and so on and so forth. You might be familiar that in volcano areas there are little stones called tuff or cinder, whatever it is. They are lightweight, they carry a lot of water, they can hold a lot of water, and they release minerals, an excellent growing medium for plants. So one of our professors, Professor Lenachem, found a way to compress the ashes in such a way that it forms a cinder-like material, and you can see it here, and this has become a standard in the industry, in the agricultural industry, so much so that the problem became a solution rather than a problem. Cotton, and this will be my last example. Cotton was introduced in Israel in the 50s and 60s as a solution to unemployment. It was introduced by an American Jew as a solution. There was a 20% or more unemployment, and people were growing cotton, and some people were picking the cotton. Believe me, I don't know why was a spy. I picked cotton when I was young. It's a very tough job in a very harsh environment. Today everything is being picked by machine. But after picking, there is always a residue of straw which is rich in woody material. And this woody material is not digestible by animals, and it doesn't decompose in the soil. So it becomes a nuisance. The solution all over the world is burning. It's true in America, it's true in Argentina, it's true in Israel. Pollution. So one of our professors, Professor Isaac Adar, on a weekly hike in the bush, found that on the dead pine trees there are mushrooms that are growing. He collected them, identified them, and found out that they're very good, edible, tasty, and so on and so forth. Trying to grow it on cotton straw, and they pressed on. They produce a beautiful cotton and beautiful mushrooms. So here we started with something in the field. We have a field. There's a problem in the field. The straw solution is not found, but you can find natural processes to harness this nuisance and grow this mushroom and give it to the cook for a good meal. But the beauty of it, that after you grow the mushroom, this woody material decomposes and it becomes edible by ruminants. And when it becomes edible by ruminants, you get also meat and milk given to the same chef, and you get a delicious meal. And I thank you very much.
Como hemos escuchado, cuando uno habla de innovación, cuando uno habla de progreso de un país, cuando uno ve esas imágenes que van del desierto a esos lugares con tanta tecnología incorporada, eso es lo que es el Estado de Israel, esa es la ventaja comparativa, y eso es algo de lo cual sentimos mucho orgullo. Las personas que trabajan y que desarrollan estas tecnologías están acá, los tenemos al lado nuestro. Entonces, vemos como del pasado al presente un pasaje realmente muy, muy interesante. Vamos a escuchar ahora al profesor Shlomo Hasson, que nos va a hablar sobre los desafíos estratégicos, sobre algunos temas que hacen a la realidad actual, más escuchando lo que pasó hace 48 horas en Jerusalén. Obviamente que las palabras del profesor Hasson toman mucho más importancia. Profesor.
Good evening, everybody. I'm very pleased to be here and to share with you this evening my thoughts about Israel 2048, the trends that will shape our life. All my life, I was bothered by the future. I don't care much about the past, but I always ask myself, what's going to happen? And how are we going to prepare ourselves for it? And I think, to use last evening, phrase, my click was when I read Theodor Herzl, Altneuland. And in this book, he writes about the building of a new society in Palestine. And he says that there are people there working the land, doing agriculture, etc. But there is another group of people, the scholars. And in order to have the scholars working for Palestine, he buys a boat in Genoa. He calls this boat Futuro, which is Futura. And these scholars, maybe the Hebrew University professors in the future, are there on the boat discussing the future of Israel. They never get to Israel. They are so busy with their thoughts about the future. I like very much this satirical way of describing the work of intellectuals. So when I call my group, you know, I said to them, we are the Futura, we are the followers of Herzl, but hopefully we won't be on the boat, we will start thinking seriously about the process of planning. Practically, I took part in most of the major plans of Israel. I took part in preparing the master plan of the District of Jerusalem, the metropolitan area of Tel Aviv. But the culmination of my work was to prepare the integrative master plan for Israel. It was approved by the Israeli government in 2005. And since then, 2005, this was the last act of Prime Minister Sharon. This plan guides the development of Israel in every sphere of planning, special planning, which is the land use, agriculture, environment, water, everything, since 2005. And now I think it's about time to come up with a new plan And this is what I'm going to do this evening, to share with you my thoughts about the new ideas, the new forces, the mega trends that are going to shape our society. When you think about mega trends that are going to shape society, whether it's Israel or Argentina or Uruguay, you have to think big. As Peres said, you have to imagine things. And you have to know that there is no way to predict the future. There are so many variables, there are so many changes. It's very hard to predict the future. So what is the alternative? To sit on our hands? No. The alternative is to look at the trends, to think about different developments, to come up with different scenarios, which is relevant to every case we are inquiring, and to see how we respond to different scenarios. So this is what I'm going to do this evening. Present you with some data, talk about trends, and then possible developments in the future. And the first mega trend that I would like to talk about is demography. I think we have to start with demography because of all the variables that I am going to show you this evening. Demography is usually the most predictable. There are some predictions now about the world population. Right now, the world population in 2017 is 5.5 billion people. We're expecting to have 2.5 billion people in 2050. And the interesting thing about it is that most of this growth is going to take place in Africa. Africa. Out of the 2 billion people that are going to be added to the world, 1 billion people will be in Africa. Just imagine one country, Nigeria. Right now, it has 190 million people. In 2050, it's going to be bigger than the United States, with 400 million people. Now, take into consideration the fact that you have Boko Haram, which is a sort of an extension of Al-Qaeda, the Islamic State, in the northeastern part of Nigeria. You have climate change. You have environmental degradation. You have corruption. The result will be a stream of refugees. Where are they going? Maybe some of them will go to nearby countries, but you can expect that the most of them will go to Europe. And this is why Europe, since this year, since 2017, is coming with a new program, how to stop migration, not from Syria, not from Afghanistan, not from Pakistan, but from Africa. And imagine that the border is open. We have already absorbed in Israel 60,000 immigrants from African countries. But if they manage to move in this direction, it could become 600,000 and even more. So when you talk about climate change and demographic change, Israel is there, always there. I would like to turn our attention to demography within Israel. Israel right now is a country of 8.6 million people. In 2065, according to a recent forecast published by the Central Bureau of Statistics, the population would be about 20 million people. But see the dramatic change that is going to happen. Right now, the Arab population forms about 21%. The ultra-Orthodox Haredi population is about 11%. In 2065, the Arab will be even less than 20%, but the ultra-Orthodox are going to be 32%. This means that the non-Haredi population in Israel will be a minority. Think about the implication. Think about a country with an excellent army, excellent security, but all of this is irrelevant to more than 50% of the population. This is a kind of scenario which says all things remain equal, but obviously things may change. The Haredi may develop a stronger attachment to the strength of Israel and start serving in the army. So this would be a different scenario. They may keep their level of commitment as it is right now, where few really go to the army, but the most do not go. And maybe some changes would happen with the Arabs. When we look at the ethnic composition, the social composition, it obviously affects the economics, because these bars, this diagram shows you the employment rate by population groups. And please notice the two bars and singled here, this one, which shows the participation in labor force of the ultra-Orthodox, which is only 50%, and the participation of Arab women in labor force, which is 32%. So if this population really grows and these levels remain as they are, Israel economy is going to be dramatically affected by the presence of this group. And if they form a majority of the country, think about the economic implications for Israel. The population is going to age, but I would like to move down to society and to the most important asset that Israel has is human capital, and it's social capital. Human capital has to do with many variables: life expectancy, health, education, income. When we look at Israel ranks among the countries in terms of human development index, Israel ranks very high. It has the 18th place out of 188 countries, which means that Israel is in the top league in terms of life expectancy, education, and income, and we should be proud of it. It's a small country without natural assets, and we reach such a good place at the top, 18th place. But the question is, what's going to happen in the future? How is the young generation doing? How is the young people at the age of 15, after compulsory school, how are they doing? And here we find that there is a huge difference between achievers and non-achievers. The average tells us almost nothing. What is more important is the variance. And here you see, here what we see is the variance. I would like to go back to the variance. The variance, which is very high. And if you look at the OECD countries, the highest variance is registered in Israel, which means that in Israel you have the highest gap between achievers and non-achievers. Why is that? Because we have the Jewish population, which is doing very well, and it ranks around, you know, the 20th place out of 72 countries. And then when it comes to the Arabs, they are about the 65, 66th place. So the average tells you nothing, because, you know, it's two islands, between them there is a sea, and the average falls into the sea. So Israel ranks today at the 40th place out of 70 countries in the PISA performance. What is the PISA performance? This is an international assessment of student achievements in the fields of literature, science, and mathematics. And what we see is a sort of a mediocre place among the nations of the world, but as I have said, this place is affected by the two different populations that exist within Israel. Another thing that we have to take into consideration is not the human capital, but the social capital, the level of solidarity in Israel. And here what you see is that our society is deeply divided between rich and poor, Jews and Arabs, state and religion, left and right. And these divisions dramatically affect the level of solidarity, the level of tolerance in Israel. But at the same time, there are uniting factors. We are united in the security issue, especially in the Jewish people. There is identification with the state. And in a recent survey, we have discovered that even the Arabs, the majority of them, are proud to be Israeli citizens. And then obviously there is Jewish tradition and culture that unite us together. So when we look at the social division and the level of solidarity, on the one hand, it's very high, especially identification with the state. On the other hand, it's very low. And it's very hard to deal with security issues, to deal with problems from the outside when you have such a division in the country. The third megatrend is the economy: globalization, growth, inequality, and migration. As you look at this map, you can see that the world becomes more and more polarized. Economic growth tends to concentrate in a small number of cities. Look at South America. You can see that there are five cities in which most of the economic growth is taking place. One of them is Buenos Aires, another is São Paulo, another is Rio de Janeiro, and you have Caracas and Bogota, but the rest is almost empty. Look at Africa, almost none. Look at Russia. Then even in the United States, most of the growth is taking place either in the East Coast or the West Coast, but the center is almost empty with one or two exceptions. And then the majority is in Western Europe and in Southeast Asia. And the interesting thing, the trend that the McKinsey reports tell us about is that the trend is to have a higher concentration of economic growth in small cities, and these small cities are going to be the engines of the world. The result is quite clear: growing inequality. Growing inequality and massive migration from the periphery to the center. And I am giving you here only two examples, one from Brazil, the immigration from the northern state to the city of the coast, and another in China, the migration from the western regions and the northern regions to the eastern coast. And this happens also in Israel, the same picture. There is a huge migration of creative people from the north, the south, Jerusalem to Tel Aviv. Resources are concentrated in Tel Aviv. Creative powers are concentrated in Tel Aviv. And the result is growing polarization between the center and Tel Aviv and the rest of the country. And obviously, this may continue if the government does not intervene. So one scenario would be business as usual, no government intervention. Another possibility is that the government intervenes and changes the trends. So we have at least two scenarios here. And when we look at the GDP of Israel, the growth of Israel, in the first decade of the 21st century, we were doing fine. The average growth was 4.5%. But look what happens now. You can see the decline, and it is stuck, and there are many reasons for this that we can discuss later on. And the GDP per capita in Israel is not bad. We are not doing bad. You can see it's about 24,000. We are over Spain, Korea, Czech Republic, and others, but we have to work hard in order to improve the situation. And unfortunately, if the growth is as it is, we are stagnated and there will be no growth. What we see in Israel, as in many other countries, is high inequality between rich and poor. And you can see that when you rank Israel and you put it in a comparative perspective, we are fifth in the world after Chile, Mexico, Turkey, and the United States. And this leads to social process, agitation, and instability. In terms of technology, which is the fourth megatrend, we are in the fourth industrial revolution. We are in an age in which we have exponential growth of computation power, automation that replaces not only human labor force, but sometimes it replaces human thinking. We are nearing the age of thinking machine, and we have to think about the implications of this for Israel and the rest of the world. When most of the work is done by robotics, what's going to happen to employment, inequality, etc.? As has been said, we have an entrepreneurial spirit which is associated with our tradition. We have a tradition of questioning. We never accept things as they are. We say something, then people will challenge you. We have the Israeli chutzpah. We are in constant war. And obviously, all of this attracts investments in technology. But look at the concentration of investments in the metropolitan areas, most of them in metropolitan areas, and most of them in the area of Tel Aviv. The Hebrew University excels in agriculture, in biotech, in pharmacology, and also artificial intelligence, Mobileye, and others, but our competitive advantage are in these three. The fifth mega process is resource management, energy, water, in the environment. And you can see that luckily we have gas resources and we are going to change the Israeli mix of energy and to move from coal to gas. You can see that we are developing pipelines all over the country, and recently we started developing pipeline to Jordan, to Gaza, to the West Bank. This is done by the Israeli government. And for the first time in Israel history, we are trying to break the iron wall that surrounds Israel and to build bridges to surrounding countries. And this is also true with regard to transportation. You can see that we have now east-west transportation lines and roads. Turkey, for example, is using this road here from Haifa to Beit She'an and then to Jordan and to the Gulf States, because the roads in Syria are blocked. There is a development of this road, road number one, that goes to Jordan. The Chinese were invited to help us in putting the railway that goes to Eilat, and they think about it as a fallback to the Suez Canal. So Israel is becoming a sort of a transition country, and this is very helpful. First of all, it connected the periphery with the center, but then with the rest of the world. And I'll move now quickly to the sixth, the geopolitics. I'll talk about it later on, tomorrow. You see that this is a region torn apart by so many conflicts and so many alliances, and we are affected by the terror activity in the Arab world, which is exported to Europe, and by the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And when we look at this, we ask ourselves one question: what is the government doing? What is the role of the government? And what we find is that Israel is a free state, but the government has many, many difficulties. And the major difficulty, this is the World Bank, a marking of Israeli achievements in the field of governance. You can see the achievement here is very low of the government. Why? Because of political instability. We are a heterogeneous society. We have many parties, and it becomes very difficult for Israel to develop a strategy, to develop a vision, and to deal with these problems. And then the question is, what is the role of the university? How can the university help? And I think that in dealing with the university, we must move from social sciences and sciences to humanity, to human sciences, to literature, to history, to philosophy. And I would like to end up with a few lines taken from a poem written by T.S. Eliot in 1934. He says, "Where is the life we have lost in living? Where is the wisdom we have lost in knowledge? Where is the knowledge we have lost in information? We live in an information society, but somehow we moved away from knowledge and we moved away from wisdom." And I think that the role of the university in such hard times is not to be just one actor among many, among the high schools and the elementary schools and society and economy and environment, but it is the role of the university to spread higher education, to spread the achievements of science to the rest of society. And we can do it in two ways. But one way is to assume a lifelong learning when we infiltrate every level of life, the home, the kindergarten, the elementary school, and then we have to develop societal engagement where we enrich human capital in every field, in education, in management of public resources, in economic growth, in democracy. If we manage to do this, we will have a situation where societal engagement and lifelong learning will go together to develop a learning society and academic leadership that will take us back from information to knowledge, and from knowledge to wisdom. Thank you very much.
Bueno, hemos escuchado dos exposiciones bien diferentes. Por un lado, la vinculada a todo el crecimiento que ha tenido el Estado de Israel en los temas de agricultura y todo lo que es el desarrollo tecnológico en ese área. Y por otro lado, los distintos escenarios que se pueden plantear a partir de distintas variables que se plantearon. Pero vamos a hacer lo siguiente. Puedo hacer preguntas, vamos a poner una regla. A todos nos gusta hablar mucho. La regla va a ser, las preguntas se pueden hacer en no más de 15 segundos, número uno. Y número dos, no queremos que nos cuenten opiniones, sino que hagan preguntas para aprovechar el conocimiento de los profesores Rabinovich y Jasón. Entonces, escuchamos, ¿quién tiene la primera pregunta? ¿Quién quiere preguntar? ¿Qué se les ocurre?
Para el profesor Jasón, si estos sistemas de planificación estratégica son exportables.
Yes, I think we can do that. I think that we have to open up to countries with similar problems and similar challenges. And I would like to speak in particular about Argentina. Recently, we have been exposed to very, very innovative idea of the president of Argentina 2030. And there is a group of people, I think, you know, best people in the academia, in the professional fields, working together to produce a vision for Argentina. I was lucky to meet with one of them, Eduardo Scechetti, Professor Eduardo Scechetti, and to think about, you know, the future of the two countries. And we had the same question, whether we can export, you know, the experience of each country to the other. And we realized that we have to organize a joint seminar of people from Argentina and people from Israel, and to think together about the future of planning and planning the future, and to share experience and to share knowledge of Argentina and Israel, and to learn from other countries. I think we can learn a lot from some European countries. I am surprised to find out that many of the Arab countries, like Saudi Arabia, for example, the Gulf states, are engaged in such a process. I'm a bit depressed that the government of Israel, because of the problems that I have shown you, is not doing the same work. And I had the opportunity to meet, you know, the chief counselor to the Prime Minister Netanyahu, Mr. Yaakov Amidor. He was the head of the security agency in Israel. And I asked him, what should we do? He said, don't wait for the government. Take it as your initiative, as academic initiative, and then from there, you can proceed and go to the government. I strongly believe that the government has to be involved. There should be bottom-up and top-down process. But the problem is where to start. Here in Argentina, you start from the top. In Israel, we start from the bottom. I think we should meet in the middle.
La pregunta del profesor Jasón. Vista la diferencia que hay entre la población judía y árabe respecto a las pruebas PISA, ¿se está haciendo algo para elevar el nivel educativo de la población árabe?
Yes, we do. Yes, we do. It is very clear that if the Arabs remain where they are right now, Israel economy is going to be badly affected, social relations are going to be badly affected, inequality will grow. So it was a decision of the Ministry of Finance and the Council of Higher Education to make a special investment in Arab students and in ultra-Orthodox students. And this is what we are trying to promote these days at the universities, including the Hebrew University. What I see today is a tendency among the Arabs and the ultra-Orthodox to become involved in this process, and I would like to give you one example. I was recently invited to handle a strategic workshop with ultra-Orthodox people, young people who are in their 30s and 40s. They are mid-level managers, you know, deputy mayors, young members of the Knesset. And I asked them, how do you see yourself, the ultra-Orthodox, in the Israeli society? And the answer was very clear. We are part of this society. We are attached. And this was something really warmed my heart, to hear it from them. And same thing I hear from pragmatic Arab people. Let's work together. And there are many groups in Israel, like Sikui, for example, which is an NGO, working together to bring together Jews and Arabs.
I think nothing should be imposed. It should be a sort of a dialogue, a sort of a civic convention between Arab and Jews, between ultra-Orthodox and others. Not everybody will be there. There are extremists on every group, okay? But I think the essence of strategic planning is to discover the pragmatic people, the center-oriented people, and to work with them.
Yo quería preguntarle cómo ve las estrategias a futuro en relación al crecimiento de la población religiosa en Israel y en qué medida eso traba o no otras posibles estrategias y líneas de trabajo.
Well, this is a really good question, and it's not easy to answer it, because the facts on the ground are that the ultra-Orthodox rabbis decline to have core curriculum, which includes mathematics, science, English in their school. So if they succeed, the ultra-Orthodox population will remain ignorant. And this is going to affect not only the ultra-Orthodox, but Israeli society at large, because as I've showed you, they are going to form one third of the population of Israel. What should be done? What should be done? I think we must find agents on both sides, the non-Orthodox and the Orthodox, that can work together and establish dialogue. The group that I presented, that I talked about in my previous answer, is made up of 40 young people. They respect the rabbis, but they know very well that without core curriculum, they are not going to succeed, and Israeli society is going to fail. So I would like to tell you a story that really happened to me in the last few weeks. I was approached by the deputy mayor of the city of Beit Shemesh. He is an ultra-Orthodox. His name is Shmuel Greenberg. And he said, Shlomo, we respect the rabbis. We are not going to introduce core curriculum to the school. But in the Jewish community centers, we are going to have it, and the parents are willing to pay. So you can see the situation. They respect the rabbis, but at the same time they understand the needs of modern society. And we, the people that would like to work with them, would respect what they are doing and help them. So I helped them to get a grant from the European Union in order to have core curriculum in the Jewish Community Center. You may criticize me and say, why don't you fight the rabbi? It's pointless. I would miss the young people. So I'm trying to find a way. This is the way of strategy of establishing dialogue.
O sea, la última pregunta.
La pregunta es para Jaime. Yo quisiera que nos oriente un poquito sobre si tenemos que estar a favor o en contra de los alimentos modificados genéticamente.
Genetic is a general code that all living organisms on earth, will it be a bacteria, will it be a human being, speak the same language. And that's why we can take genes or pieces of DNA, could be pieces of 9, 10 letters of DNA from one organism, transfer it to another organism, and it will be expressed in the other organism as if it was its own. Let's take medicine, for instance. There are a lot of diseases, we know today that there are a lot of diseases that are genetically controlled. Now, if we had to do all the experiments on human beings, probably we'd have to extend our graveyards. We do it now with mice. How do we do it with mice? We transfer the gene, the defective gene, into mice, and then study the disease and study the way to treat it. Similarly, I can talk about food. We talk today about functional foods, foods that not only give us calories and maybe good flavor, but also contribute to our health. For instance, the red color of tomato reduces the risk of prostate cancer and of breast cancer. So the question is, do we fight against it, or do we say, oh, say let's go for irradiation, or let's say go for chemistry, or go for things like that? Or just eat more tomatoes enriched with vitamin. There's nothing wrong with GMO. In Judaism, by the way, there's no objection to GMO, because in Judaism there's a rule that says diluted by 60 is okay. And if you dilute something by 60, it could be pork in the meat, it would be okay. And since we have 30,000 genes, if you add a gene into our body, it doesn't matter. None of the objectors of GMO, when it comes to health, have anything to say about it. They all, if their kid is sick, or wife is sick, or husband is sick, or parents is sick, they don't care. They will take GMO medicine whatsoever. When it comes to food, it's more economic warfare of the Europeans against the Americans, against Argentina, if you like, and others, because America is 10 generations more advanced than Europe with regard to genetic engineering, and they're afraid that if they will allow genetic engineering product going to Europe, Europe agriculture will be eliminated. So this is the whole story.
Okay. Para cerrar, vamos a invitar a Edu Pollack. Edu es el director del Departamento Latinoamericano de la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén. Edu.
Bueno, voy a ser breve. A mí me gustaría hacer una conexión entre las dos exposiciones que tuvimos, la de Shlomo Hasson con los planes estratégicos y la de Jaime Rabinovich relacionado con la agricultura. Uno de los puntos los cuales más me dio a pensar es el futuro de África, por ejemplo, en el cual de aquí a pocos años va a haber una población de 1 billón de personas más, 1.000 millones de personas más que van a estar necesitados de hoy, de algo que falta y que es escaso en África, tanto el agua como la comida. Y eso lo relaciono con la Facultad de Agricultura. Y la pregunta que siempre tenemos nosotros, ¿cómo es que nosotros influenciamos en el mundo y en el futuro del mundo? Ya lo dije en alguna oportunidad que una de nuestras funciones como universidad líder en el mundo es traer una mejoría al mundo en temas de cultura, sociedad, y dar de comer al mundo, traer una mejor forma, mejores frutas, mejores verduras, animales que tengan más durabilidad, como el trabajo y la investigación que tiene el profesor Rabinovich, y que puedan tener más nutrientes. Y voy a darles un ejemplo. En la Facultad de Agricultura tenemos una escuela internacional, y en esta escuela internacional participan todos los años jóvenes que vienen ya preparados con su BA, con su título de egresado de universidad, en los cuales vienen a hacer una maestría para mejorar sus conocimientos, y cada uno de ellos viene y se enfoca en algo específico que le interesa o que puede utilizarlo, implementarlo en su lugar de origen. Tenemos muchos estudiantes que vienen de África, y me gustaría comentarles un solo ejemplo. El ejemplo de un joven que vino de una aldea de África, pudo, a pesar de las dificultades que tenía, él pudo terminar su universidad y vino a mejorarse, vino a hacer una maestría. Y en esta maestría él se enfocó en criar peces, pero no a grandes escalas, sino en pequeñas escalas. Cómo criarlos, cómo atenderlos, qué darles de comer, cómo tratar el agua. Y cuando él terminó su maestría, volvió a su pequeña aldea, reunió a los integrantes de la aldea y a cada uno de ellos les enseñó cómo cavar un pozo, cada uno en el frente de su choza, cómo cubrir el pozo con algún material impermeable. Él trajo peces para cada una de las familias y les enseñó a cada uno cómo tiene que tratar el agua, cómo tiene que alimentarlos para que puedan crecer y reproducirse, y cuánto cada uno, cada familia puede consumir por día o por semana para permitir a los peces, por un lado, no consumir demasiado para que desaparezcan y no consumir poco para que no lleguen a una explosión. Y fíjense que esta sigue siendo la única fuente de proteínas que tienen los niños en esa aldea, los adultos en esa aldea, y todo eso es producto de la Facultad de Agricultura que tenemos y la Escuela Internacional. Y ahora lo relaciono esto con nuestros amigos que tenemos en el mundo, en este caso tanto los amigos argentinos como los uruguayos. Todo esto no hubiera sido posible si no fuera por parte de los recursos que tenemos en la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén, que viene a través de nuestros donantes y nuestra gente, que son verdaderos amigos. Porque estos jóvenes que vienen a estudiar, en este caso en la Facultad de Agricultura, están siendo financiados por amigos que tenemos a lo largo y a lo ancho del mundo. Entonces, cada uno de estos amigos que con su generosidad nos permiten seguir trabajando en la universidad y dándole la posibilidad a estos jóvenes, o a este joven, por ejemplo, no solo que nos ayudan a la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén, no solo que nos ayudan a Israel mismo a seguir estando en la vanguardia de la tecnología, trayendo la luz al mundo, sino que ayudamos de una forma indirecta, en este caso África, pero en otros casos también América Latina, Asia, y en todo el mundo está siendo implementado lo que generamos y lo que enseñamos en la Universidad Hebrea de Jerusalén. Me gustaría agradecer a los organizadores, aquí los amigos argentinos, los amigos uruguayos. Me gustaría agradecer a los profesores que se desplazaron desde Jerusalén para poder compartir con nosotros esta noche, la de ayer y lo que tendremos. Y me gustaría agradecer a todos los participantes que están aquí por haber presenciado, por haber estado con nosotros. Y lo último que me resta es invitarlos a todos a Jerusalén, a la Universidad Hebrea, para que puedan seguir disfrutando de todo el bienestar y la investigación y el conocimiento que generamos para iluminarnos y entender cómo una universidad líder funciona para traer una mejoría al mundo. Muchas gracias.